Well, good evening, guys, and welcome to another session here of our midweek Bible study. And we are continuing, or probably I should say getting back to the book of Job in our series, Looking Beyond Suffering. I know we've been dealing with it now for, I'd say just about a little over a month, maybe two. And now we're in our 10th lesson going on into Job chapter 4. And we are really going to be fast forwarding throughout the remaining bulk of the book of Job. And the reason why I want to say that, I just want to give you guys kind of a little bit of a fair warning. Because from here, like even tonight, we're going to be covering about three chapters. I'm still going to keep it within the 15 to 20 minute ratio as we've been getting adjusted to in our live stream sessions. But I just wanted to let you guys know that if you're wanting to dig deeper, if you're wanting to say, hey, you know, Pastor, I want to get into the details of it, I really encourage you to go back. You know, this will be your homework for tonight, to go back through the chapters that we covered. You can even pause me at a later time and just kind of go through the verses of the sections that we're going to be covering. But really, as I made mention of in the last week or in the weeks prior, when we get into from Job chapter 4 onwards to about Job chapter 37, I believe, we're dealing with the conversations that Job and his three friends are having with one another. And really, they're answering the question of why is Job suffering? And why did God allow this? Now, we don't necessarily know that from the audience's perspective, but Job chapter 1 and Job chapter 2-ish really gives us that answer from our perspective, because we had the heavenly perspective. We've seen what went on beyond the curtains. Like I made mention of, it's kind of like a grand Shakespearean play that we're looking at. We saw the scene up in heaven between God and Satan. So we know, in a sense, why this happened to Job. It wasn't because of Job. It wasn't because of his sin. It wasn't because God was trying to chastise Job for something that he did wrong. All it really was God offering Job unto Satan and saying, look at my faithful servant. He will not curse me if you do these things unto him. And Job didn't. So we know why Job is suffering. It's because of God and Satan's conversation in that trial period. Not the full essence of why, but we know the cause and effect of it. Job obviously has no clue. And so from the book of Job chapter 4 to Job chapter 37, all four of these men, Job and his three friends, are trying to figure out why. So it's not in the sense that the word of God is insufficient or lack of benefit to you and I. But while they are figuring this out, we already know the perspective, so we do not have to get so deep into the verses, into the structure, try to delve into it, because Job chapter 1 and Job chapter 2 already answered it. So the question would be then, that we're asking ourselves tonight, is why would we benefit from the book of Job then? Why is Job not just 10 chapters instead of some 42 chapters? And that's a great question. Here's an answer to it to give you some food for thought. The answer for you and I, that what we can glean from Job, is that we can probably perhaps find ourselves in one of these conversations, if not more of these conversations, in giving the advice that we've given to friends and loved ones when they were suffering, or being on the receiving end of some of the advice that we're going to be looking at in the coming weeks and reacting from that advice. Or maybe even you have had some personal thoughts that you're dealing with either today, recently, or in times past that will sink to the conversations and the structures of the conversations and the ideas of the conversations that we're going to be talking about. So why is it beneficial? Well, it's not necessarily beneficial to Job and his three friends in the context, but it is beneficial for you and I, because in our life's perspective, we don't see the behind the curtains view. We don't see what's going on in the spiritual realm of things. We oftentimes don't see God's hand moving in our life. And so oftentimes we find ourselves in the seat of Job or one of his three friends and the advice that they're given. So we do see benefit in that aspect, but they do offer some bad advice for Job, and sometimes they offer bad advice even for us as modern day Christians and readers. And so we're going to be looking at that tonight. Let us go ahead and pray, and we'll probably spend about now just about 10 or 15 minutes onto the topic, and I'll try to do as best I can. We are definitely probably going to be breaking this out in two or three sections for less than 10 here, so it's just going to be, that's why I titled it Less Than 10A. We may not even finish it, so we'll just see how far we get to go with it. But I pray it's a benefit to you. Stick around tonight. If you have a prayer request, just go ahead and add it into the DM or add it into your message there, or even message me or message the church privately. I'm going to give us a few minutes between our Bible study and our prayer time to pray for our corporate church prayer request and let some of that be known unto other loved ones as well. Of course, we always have our prayer chain and emails as well if you want to see that avenue as well. But we are going to have a time of midweek prayer after the Bible study always. So stick around for a few minutes if you desire to be in spirit with that. But nonetheless, let's go ahead and ask the Lord to bless our time and the studying of His Word this evening. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we love You. Lord, we enter into the throne of grace today. And Father, Lord, we just pray that we will be gleaning something from the book of Job tonight. Perhaps, as I made mention of, Father, we will find ourselves in the structure and the context and the ideologies that will be spoken tonight of. And Lord, perhaps, you know, this will be either ammunition unto us to use later on in our lives or someone else, or medicine to us today so that we can receive new fresh wisdom or new insight and things that perhaps are going on in our life or our loved ones. So Father, Lord, I pray that tonight will be beneficial to our hearts, to our minds, to our spirits, Lord. And Lord, that the Word will be saturated into our hearts and to our lives and not of our opinions encompass. So Father, Lord, we pray these things unto You now. In Jesus' name, amen. So if you have your Bible, let's go ahead and go to Job chapter 4, and I'll pull up our slides here, and we'll be going through those as always. So here in Job chapter 4, we're looking at, in the beginning, the midweek Bible study, the midweek Bible study of Job. And so what are we looking at here really specifically? Well, as I made mention of, if you don't have it already, I'm always going to keep this up here because I want to let you guys know, always forthright, always transparent, that we are using the book called Beyond Suffering. Now, my series title is kind of playing on words, Looking Beyond Suffering. But if you want to get more, if you want to get more insight, if you liked some of the ideas that are presented in our studies tonight, I really encourage you to grab this book. It would be a blessing to you in answering perhaps some of the problems, some of the situations that you find yourself in life's trials and woes as well. So this is the book that we're using to complement the Word, never in replace of the Word, but a lot of the ideas and insights that I'll be speaking of will come off of the structure of what Dr. Leighton Talbert had spent many months and many years into the book of Job researching. So just want to give you guys that insight there as well. So continuing on, here's our title for tonight's Bible study. Our title for tonight's Bible study is this, Lesson 10, Section A, the first aspect here, well-meaning friends, yet still being misguided counselors. That's the chapter of the title, and I added the A part because we will not be getting through all of the lesson here from his commentary and through our study tonight. I absolutely 100% know it. So we planned ahead. Lesson 10A, well-meaning friends, yet misguided counselors. So, look with you if you have your Bible there. We're going to go through, and I'm not going to read verse for verse because it'll probably spend the next 10 minutes just trying to go through Job chapter 4 to 7. But what we're going to find here is the first aspect is friend number one, Eliphaz, and what his topic was, what he was telling Job was this. He said that Job needed to appreciate God's correction because Job had sinned in the eyes of Eliphaz, and Job needed to return to God. That's all a conversation number one from Job chapter 4 to Job chapter 5. Eliphaz is telling Job, hey man, you did something wrong. Why don't you just go back to God and get your life straightened out? And then all of this will start, you know, will start loosening up. Things will start getting better. You know, the problems in your life is because of sin. So let's go ahead and continue on with that insight there. And what we find here is sympathetic reasoning from chapter 4, verse 1 to verse 11. If you want to outline this, if you are just marking in your Bible, maybe just wanting to kind of start sectioning off the book of Job, maybe you've never done this before. Maybe you've never really tackled the book of Job. Maybe you've never even broken it down. You know, you're saying, Pastor, it's all just been a bunch of words and sentences to me. Go ahead and start making these outlines. I really encourage you. It's going to be beneficial. So this first outline there was Job chapter 4 to 5, Eliphaz, and the topic of what he was saying from those two chapters. And then digging into deeper, sympathetic reasonings, what Eliphaz was telling Job. And so why do we say that? Because really, Eliphaz, has had a bad rap, along with the other friends of Job. They've all been accused of being narcissistic. They've been accused of being sarcastic. They've been accused of being snobby-nosed. They've been accused of being legalist. They've been accused of being pharisaical. You know, somebody who just kind of ups their nose at the problems that are going on. But Eliphaz, from verse 1 to verse 11, really is more compassionate. And we see this in the actions of his friends here, specifically his three friends, that the rap that they got was really not due diligence, wasn't really justice for them. Because for these three friends to sit in the dirt, in the ashes, with Job, and not say a single word for 7 complete days and 7 complete nights straight, shows compassion unto the man Job. And the reason why we see that, and the reason why we say that, because I don't know about you, but if I was in a position where I saw somebody hurting and I knew it was because of sin, you know, maybe an alcoholic losing his home and losing his life and his relationships because of his addiction to alcohol or whatever, I would not sit with that man 7 days and 7 nights in complete silence. I wouldn't just let him try to recover some decency of normalcy if I knew that he was in the wrong and I wanted to give him instruction. That's not the spirit. If you were a parent talking to a child, you wouldn't just sit there silently with your child for hours and letting them just sit there. You would give them instruction. You would try to correct the action that you know they did wrong in and try to reinforce them to do it better. So the friends of Job sat there compassionately with Job. They were just trying to be kindred spirits. They were trying to sit there with him, mourn with him, and lovingly embrace him with a silent presence. So their spirit was not one of instruction, criticism, not one of instruction, because of course they're instructing him, but more on the left side of criticism, sarcasm, belittling. That's not where his friends were coming at all. So when you read these verses, do not insert that tone, but rather insert a tone of compassion, of loving one, of one who's just trying to give good advice, sound truth to someone that they think needs it, but really still in a compassionate, very fragile, very beat around the bush, softened way. So we want to focus on that mindset there. And really what we're looking at here, if I can get my thing straight, really what we're looking at here in essence is the sympathetic reasoning there. And next what we're looking at is the sober warning. Now what do we mean by that sober warning? Well, that's the next outline here, and it's the sober warning. And what he meant by that was, and the sober warning is really looked at the verse that we're going to look at. Shall mortal man be more just than God, and shall a man be more pure than his maker? You say, Pastor, that absolutely makes no sense in what you just said. Well, stick with that verse there. Shall a mortal man be more just than God? Shall a man be more pure than his maker? If you got your Bible up, just stick your finger right there. And I'm going to switch over here again. So, shall a mortal man be more just than God? And shall a man be more than his maker? Well, look with me in Job chapter 4. So, you got your finger stuck on Job chapter 4, verse 17. Well, look with me back in Job chapter 4, verses 1 to 3 here. So Eliphaz the Temanite answered and said, "If we essay to commune with thee, wilt thou be grieved? But who can withhold himself from speaking? Behold, thou hast instructed many. Thou hast strengthened the weak hands. Thy words have upholden him that was fallen, and thou hast strengthened the feeble knees. But now it has come upon thee." So then, Eliphaz is saying, "Job, you are a decent man. You are a godly man. You are one of the best men that I have ever known. And so now the advice that you've shared into the community, you need to receive as well." And the capstone verse of his entire argument, his entire proposition, if you will, is Job chapter 4, verse 17, where he's pretty much telling Job, "Job, even though you're a great man, even though you're a most perfect man, can you be more perfect than God? Can you be more pure than your maker?" Because remember what Job said in Job chapter 3, that long, detailed, gloomy expression of not suicidal, wasn't suicidal, but just deep depression that he had to express out of his spirit. Remember, his spouse left him. His children are all dead. His cattle is pretty much gone. His livelihood is dead. His personal body is conflicted with bruises and diseases and afflictions. And Job, just out of depression, just pretty much wails to God and asks us, "God, if this is my life, if I have done something so wrong against you, I looked at my life, I see nothing done wrong, please, God, in my life," is what Job was saying. And so Job was pretty much not necessarily rebuking God, but said, "God, if you are not in my life no more, why am I yet still here?" is what he was asking God. And Eliphaz was therefore saying, "Job, you cannot ask such questions, because who are you compared to God? And who are you to be more righteous than your maker?" And this was a true thought, because God even accused Job of this very thing. Look with me, and I'm going to give you this verse here in just for a second. In Job chapter 40, verse 8, God accuses Job of this very thing, because he says, this is God talking to Job in this verse. We're trying to fast forward in a few chapters. But God tells Job, "Job, will you disannul my judgment? Are you telling me that the things that I did into your life, you don't agree with? Are you condemning me, Job? Are you telling me that I was wrong to do the things in your life? And are you saying that you are more righteous than me?" God was challenging Job and pretty much telling Job, "Job, do you think you're better than me?" Because that's why he goes on into the list of things that God does in the world, from Job chapter 37 to 39, where God tells Job, "You know, Job, tell me how many drops are in the ocean. Tell me how many stars are in the sky. Count the sand, Job. Job, if you think you're better than me, then do the things that I do if you think you're better than me." And we think, man, that's a pretty harsh remark for Eliphaz to give unto Job. I mean, my goodness, he just lost his wife, his kids. Why are you telling him that he shouldn't think himself better than Job? Because Job, either intentionally or unintentionally, had that spirit. And that's a warning for you and I today. Remember, Job did not blame God, but whether he intended it to or not, or whether he meant it to or not, the words that he said pretty much was, "God, I don't agree with my estate in life no more. I don't agree with where you put me. So now I want you to end your plan in my life. I'm not going to do it, but I want you to do it. I want you to end your plan in my life, and I want to go up to heaven. I'm done with this life. I'm done with your plan, and I'm done with what you've given me for my lot." And for some of us, we may not go to the extreme that Job just said, but for some of us, we have that same degree of spirit in our hearts. When we do not like what God has given us in our life, when we do not like what God is doing in our life, we begin to either try to work it out in our own will and way, or we pretty much ask God, "God, what did I do to deserve this? God, why are you making me go through this? God, this is unfair to me. I don't agree with what you're doing. I don't like your plan in my life." And the same warning that Eliphaz gave to Job is the same warning that you need to hear, you and I both, I should say, need to heed to not today. And that is this. This is an accession from coming out of Dr. Talbert. He made this comment, and it's a powerful comment. Whenever we think that God is being unfair, or that we would never do some of the things God does, we make ourselves more righteous than God. You say, well, I would never question God. I have never done that, Pastor. I have never questioned God. I have never said that. I would never disagree with God on some of the things he does. And maybe you say that quickly, because for some of us, myself included, I think we all have. When we see a spouse die in a family prematurely, when we see a loved one going through years and years of hardships, physical hardships, mental hardships, when we see a parent lose a child prematurely, or a loss of a baby before ever was born into this world, we cannot help ourselves but either for just a moment or for a day or for a lingering thought in our minds, ask ourselves, God, if this is my lot, why would you give it to me? And Eliphaz in the Bible questions that and says, if we have that mindset, we need to be careful, because in that mindset we are sinning against God, because we are pretty much telling God, God, I don't agree with your plan, and I think your plan for me is wrong. Which is wrong. It's sin. Because God is complete perfect, God is complete holy, God is complete just, God is complete love. He is, we put him as God the Father, but yet we cannot take the abstraction out that Jesus Christ is equal to God and both share the same mindset and thoughts and actions. And so the same Christ that died for your sin and mine on Calvary is the same God, is the same Christ that acts in your life and mine today. So if we trust what he did 2,000 years ago, but don't trust what he does in our life today, that is sin. And that's what Eliphaz was trying to show Job. And so we next see in this section what Eliphaz was ending with, an impassioned appeal. An impassioned appeal. I'm going to wrap this up. I didn't even get to finish my first lesson, but we're going to wrap this up because it's going to just take probably about another 30 minutes, and I don't want to do that to you guys. But an impassioned appeal, we'll close up here on chapter 5, and we'll get into Job's reply next time. So an impassioned appeal. Eliphaz really emphasizes this. So he questioned Job and said, look, Job, what you're doing is wrong, but pay attention to this right here. So he concludes with the graciousness of God emphasized. Chapter 5, verse 17 to 27. The graciousness of God emphasized. We'll read verses 17 to 27 and end this thought, because it's a really powerful excerpt. And if you do some studies on it from Job chapter 17 to verse 27, even if you have your cross-reference Bible, if you got a cross-reference Bible, excuse me, you're going to find a lot of cross-references out of Job chapter 5, 17 through 27. David talks about it. It's a lot of these verses are put into the book of the Hebrew. A lot of these verses are extracted and put into the New Testament. It is some of the most profound and prolific thoughts about God's grace in the Old Testament that is beneficial to our hearts tonight. So let's go ahead and read that, and we'll talk about it. Behold, happy is the man whom God correcteth, therefore despise not thou the chastening of the Almighty. For he maketh sore and bindeth up. He woundeth, and his hands make whole. He shall deliver thee in six troubles, yea, in seven there shall be no evil touch thee. In famine he shall redeem thee from death, and in war from the power of the sword. Thou shalt be hid from the scourge of the tongue, neither shalt thou be afraid of destruction when it cometh. At destruction and famine thou shalt laugh, neither shalt thou be afraid of the beast of the earth, for thou shalt be in league with the stones of the field, and the beast of the field shall be at peace with thee. And thou shalt know that thy tabernacle shall be in peace, and thou shalt visit thy habitation, and shalt not sin. Thou shalt know also that thy seed shall be great, and thine offspring as the grass of the earth. Thou shalt come to thy grave in a full age, like a shock of corn cometh in his seed. in his season. Lo, this we have searched it, so it is. Hear it, and know thou it, and know thou it for thy good. And so what Eliphaz was pretty much saying from is the chapter in verse 17 and pretty much all the sub-descriptions from verse 17 is that God is a gracious God, and that is true. Unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on where your life is and depending on how you look at it, a lot of the problems that are in your life and mine tonight, friend, are caused from our actions. Like I said, Job was one of the most righteous men that ever walked the earth. He was one of the most pious men that ever walked the earth. God himself even said of Job, there is no better man on the walk of the earth than my child, Job. I would challenge us to say, if we really looked into our hearts, we would probably find that we are not as pious as Job. And we would probably find that some of the things that are going on in our life, not all of the things, if you're sitting there saying, man, I mean, what am I doing all in my life? Are you saying that my life is problems is taught by my sin? No, I'm not God. But if we really search our hearts and search our lives tonight, we may find some aspects there, some lifestyle behaviors, some lifestyle choices, some things that are going on in your life and mine that come from, that stem from bad choices that we have made. Maybe it's just prone to being angry, and therefore you have relationship problems in your family, in your work, in your church. Prone to addictions of other things outside of drugs. You know, it can be the lust of the eyes or the addictions to food. And those could cause problems in the relationships of your loved ones and friends and others. And so what we find, though, in all of our poor choices, God is still a gracious God. And I love that this is in the Old Testament. Remember what we talked about last Wednesday? How in the book of John, John says that the law of Moses is, the law came from Moses, but Christ, when he was born, brought what? Grace and truth. God has always been a gracious God. He has always given us more grace than we deserve. Even as a Christian tonight, my friends, he has given you grace more than you deserve. He is giving you blessings. He is band-aiding the mistakes that you've made in your life. He is erasing the things that are going on in your life. Even some of the things that we take for granted, he is working behind us and cleaning up after us. I mean, he's like the dad that's trying to follow after a two-year-old kid, trying to put everything back in place when the kid's just being a terrorist in the house, destroying everything. He's that kind of father unto us. No matter what we do at times as a Christian, God's grace will always be sufficient for us. And no person on this earth can ever run away, can ever walk away, can ever live outside the grace of God, because the cross covers all. You can live in the most vilest and wicked way and still come to Jesus with a repentant heart and ask for forgiveness. God's grace is sufficient for you tonight, my friend. God's grace is sufficient for you for all your life. And God's grace will be sufficient for Job, as we find out. Even though Job did nothing wrong, Job's going to find God's grace at the end of this chapter, at the end of this, well, actually at the end of this story. Look forward to continuing this. I'm sorry we didn't get to finish it, but it's really, really good, and it's really beneficial. Look forward to continuing this tomorrow, or actually, no, next Wednesday. And I pray that you guys have a happy new year. Stick around for a few minutes for a quick word of prayer for our church family if you want to. If not, have a happy new year. And I'll see you guys this coming Sunday, Lord willing. Have a blessed one. Thanks for sticking around tonight, guys, and appreciate your faithfulness. Appreciate your love unto us here at Fairbanks Missionary Baptist Church. If you are a friend of our church, again, I just want to say thank you for your faithfulness. And if you are a church member, thank you for being faithful. It really is an encouragement to me as the preacher, as just a person getting behind the camera and not being able to see the faces, enjoying seeing the blessings coming out of this. So pray this series really is being a blessing unto you. Again, you know, I'm not trying to look for a pat in the back, but, you know, if it really has been a blessing to you, you know, I hope that you can find a way to express that. I hope that you find the blessing in this. You know, it's one thing to just say, oh man, the preacher's been preaching some good messages. It's another thing to look in your life and saying, wow, God has used this message to physically change my life in this realm. So if that's been the case, I love, not for me, I don't want the pat on the back, but really, you know, share that being a praise unto the Lord, maybe tonight in your prayers, or make mention of it, you know, with others, however you want to do that. But it really has been a blessing to me studying it, and I pray it's been a blessing to you as well. So tonight we've really only got one prayer request that has been brought before my heart, and looking at my phone here, seeing some of you guys and all your lovely faces and watching us, I'm going to go ahead and pop over here. Doesn't look like we have much going on in the realm of communication, which is fine. So the one prayer request that we have tonight, that is new, a new request, I should say, is from Judy Watson. She just wanted to give us that praise that her dear friend Joanne from Indianapolis has recovered from COVID, and that is a remarkable, remarkable feat, for she's in her late 70s. And her husband is in the middle 80s, I would assume. And so Joanne is full recovery, full bill of health. God's hand's been on her and really, really doing well. So continue to give her, give God the praise for her healing. And speaking of COVID, I guess there is one more prayer request from my heart, from my family. If you guys would, I'd love for you to pray for a dear friend of mine who I've come to know this year named Ben. He is the fiance of my mother. And so talking about COVID, he is actually not doing too well. Actually, the doctors are already talking about making some life choices. Whether he's on pretty much, what do they say, the ventilator and on life support. That's the word I was looking for, on life support. And so his family's going to be making some pretty tough choices in the next couple of weeks. And so I would just ask that you pray for Ben DeLuca, BENDELUCA. And so continue to pray for him and for the family as a whole. I know they would greatly appreciate that. And so there's this again, telling you the extremities of this COVID thing. A 70-year-old woman survives COVID and is healed perfectly. A middle 50-year-old man that is fit as a horse is now on the internal decisions between this side of Jordan and that. So pray for those that are having COVID, that are facing COVID. It is some odd times that we're living in. So let's go ahead and just go to the Lord before in prayer with these prayer requests, and for our church, and perhaps even for our sister churches and our gospel preaching churches in our country that are dealing with similar issues as well, and for families that are suffering. So let's go ahead and go before the Lord just for a few minutes tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. Lord, we approach the throne of grace tonight, and Lord, we are so thankful that you are a God of attentive detail, that you are a God that gives us grace and fixes our problems whether we see it or not. Especially, really, specifically, even as Christians, Lord, you do that. You've given us salvation, and on top of that, your grace just keeps on giving. It's the gift that keeps on giving. And Lord, you are continuing to fix problems in our life, and even the poor choices that we make, you put grace over. And Lord, even we ought to go before you and ask for forgiveness, and I know many of us do, but there's, you know, bound to be sins that we just leave unconfessed in throughout our day. Surely we sin more than we know each day, and Lord, your grace covers all. We thank you for that grace. Thank you for the account that Eliphaz has given us in Job chapter 5, and I pray that that is a praise of our heart for all the good things that you've done in our life specifically as well. But Father, Lord, I want to give you the praise as we speak about praise for Judy Watson's friend Joanne, who has from all of our accounts, from what the doctor has seen, recovered 100% from COVID virus, and her husband both. And so, Lord, we just give you the praise for that. Lord, we pray that this virus doesn't come back unto them or anything similar. And we just pray that there be no long-term effects from this as well. So, Lord, we pray for her health and thank you for her recovery. But, Lord, we also pray for those that are in the same position as my dear friend Ben. And Lord, we pray for him. Pray that, you know, he really is in a tough spot. Again, we find ourselves in this position that Job said, Lord, if it was up to me, I wouldn't have done this. I would have let him live. I would let him prosper. I would let him bounce back. But God, it's not up to me. And it would be sinful for me to say that I'm more righteous than you, and I want to be in your shoes to fix this. So, Lord, help us in these times of struggle and these times of things that just don't show much clarity in, but yet your hand is still in to give us that comfort. Lord, be with his family specifically. Lord, be with his loved ones. Be with those who love him and entrusted their lives unto him. Lord, we pray that you, as selfishly as we pray for his healing. We pray for those that are hurting right now in COVID as well, not just him, but those like him. We pray for their healing. But Lord, as mature Christians as we ought to be, we do say, let your will be done and not our own. For your grace and your honor will go forth beyond all this, and you will receive the praise for all things we know. So Lord, we trust these things unto you, and we ask for your comfort during these times. Be with our church family as we strive forward in the year of 2021 to try to give honor unto you and strive to plant the gospel and raise disciples. Lord, we also want to pray for our gospel preaching sister churches all across the world, all across our country, who are suffering right now in like manner and dealing with the same problems that perhaps we are dealing with, families with COVID, friends with COVID. And so, Father, Lord, we pray these things and ask that your Holy Spirit come forth in this time of difficulty for the world, and perhaps let us be able to share the gospel more better than we ever can in the opportunities that abound for us. We pray these things now in your Holy Son's name, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. God be with you, friends, and God bless you as well as you guys are going to be approaching now into the New Year's holidays in the next couple of days. Pray it's a safe one for you. I pray that you have a good one as well. And maybe perhaps as I was telling my church this last Sunday morning, go ahead and add some spiritual New Year's resolutions. Maybe there's some things that you can do for God next year that you haven't done perhaps this year. And one of those things would be taking advantage of the culture that we live in to be better soul winners, better gospel planters, and pointing those who are without hope to the one who gives hope. Love you guys. See you again. Good Lord willing. Have a blessed one. God bless.